Oh, thank God, there are more people eat these fish. Oh, my God, I was hoping I wouldn't have to take all these home.
We got that card.
Yeah.
I'm going to have a biscuit as well. Help yourself, pass them around. I explained that these are from my, oh my gosh, something. I explained that my wife has a baking problem. This time of year, she just does nothing but bake these pumps. Wow, that is surreal seeing you on there, Eric, because you're sitting right behind me.
Oh, yeah.
But we can't see you. Okay. All right, now let's see. So I've pasted in the link. This is the website. I like to see where we've been, where we are, and where we're going. If we look past all of the meetings that we did this year, we did quite a lot of meetings, mostly weekly, although we started a little bit late. This is about the third or fourth version of the website that I've started. And you can link at the bottom and follow the path to all the old websites, which still exist. And you can find most of that material if you want. I don't think very many people do. What we're doing today is a data viz activity conducive to beginners. I noticed, I'm glad some other postdoc showed up because then there was only the one postdoc before you guys showed up. And what the plan is, what my plan is at the moment, is to start the boot camp next year and use, a few months of meetings for the boot camp. We might slip in maybe every fourth meeting some other topic, but most of them will do the boot camp. And if people want to come, we'll keep doing that. So the boot camp, as you know, is a beginner-friendly, self-led thing, but it's hard to get the most out of it if you're just working on your own. So maybe people will get something out of it. What I've done today is something very simple. Now, I was hoping there would be some real beginners in R, but it's the usual suspects where most of the people here I know have used R. Some are experts in R or near experts in R. But I've made a very simple data viz exercise that's meant to be an introduction to show how we use R with a real example. I tried my best to make this a holiday-themed example. It's very subtle, but I'll point it out when we come to it, the holiday theme part. So I made a couple of slides to illustrate the concept, and you can just download these if you like to download them and follow along. But this will be very quick. I'm going to change my display. There we go. So it's data and visualization for beginners. Here's the concept. What we're doing today is to introduce beginners to everything about doing real data analysis in R. Focus is going to be just demonstrating the basics, both for performing a statistical test, a simple statistical test, and for, you know, your graph. What I had hoped is if there are some people who have never used R, but who managed to install R, that together we could walk those people through and they would be able to do literally not only their very first stats analysis, reading in data, making a graph, but a last part of it is creating a report with Markdown. And so I've created very simple files, a simulated data set to do that. And that's what you get out of today's session, an introduction to linear regression and in R, most statistics that we tend to use are a form of linear model, linear regression being a particularly familiar one. And I've kind of given up. For those of you who know me and have been doing R stuff with me for years, you know that maybe early in that time that I almost rejected ggplot and the tidyverse completely. But I have just basically given up, and I've just started teaching and using ggplot on a daily basis for myself. It is useful. I think it's the reason I rejected it initially was it is slightly harder to start learning. But I think once you get over the initial hump, it's actually easier to keep using to do sophisticated things. So I chose to use a ggplot example, and then I've converted the demonstration that I'll do of the linear regression and the ggplot to a markdown script. And everybody, without changing a single line of code, without doing any coding today, should be able to run these examples if they wish. Okay, so that's all the slides that I have. I'm just going to close this down and go back to the website and point to this. I just make it a bit bigger for folks. This file zip. Now, if you mouse over this without clicking initially, you can see down in the lower left of my screen. I'll point to it, but it goes away when I'm not mousing over. But down there, you can see that this is called something like a winter holiday agriculture analysis .zip. Okay. And so you can download that. And it will download and open it up in your download place. If you look inside that file, you'll see three files in the zip. I can't make this larger without unsharing and resharing. So I'm just going to, if you find this hard to see, you have to bear with me for a second, but these are the three files. Now, one of them we can see is a .r file. It's just a text file that's got R script in it. And another file is a .rmd file. RMD is short for R markdown. And that is also just a simple text file with markdown code in it, R markdown code in it. And then there's a CSV with the data in it, which we'll have a look at together in a second. The thing for beginners, a thing I would point out here is that if you have installed R and RStudio on your laptop or your computer, Windows and Macs, and Linux these days as well. I don't know if anybody will be using Linux, but they all do a little trick for us. That's a trick of convenience, that if they recognize the program that should by default open a file, they give a little icon to it. I don't think I can increase the size of those in the zip file, but what you want to do with these is you want to pick a place on your computer. Any folder will do. Choose a place and unzip these to that place. So if people want to follow along, I'll let you do that now. Again, I'll just copy and paste the website so that you're with us. And if you want to follow along, you can. And we're talking about this link here that says files, which is a zip file. Just going through this again because I noticed there have been a couple of people that just joined. And these are the files in there. So for the exercise, if you want to follow along, you're just going to unzip these to a place on your computer. So I'm going to bring up a folder. This is my downloads folder. For our purposes today, even though these already live on my computer, I'm going to go to my desktop and I'm just going to make a new folder. I'm going to call this, winter data. I'm going to open that. Okay, so I've just made this new folder on my desktop. And you can unzip this any way you wish, but one way is just to drag over those files. Okay. I can make this a little bit bigger. And as I was saying, the default on most operating systems, if you've used R and RStudio before, is that there's an icon represented by the program that's going to open it. Thing I wanted to point out is depending on your level of comfort and familiarity with, really making computers work for you as a tool, The default settings are, when we look at these file names for most operating systems, there's a dot and then there's what we call an extension. And for the default settings for most people are that we can't view those extension names, although I find it really convenient to actually let me see the full file name. If you'd like to, and you're using Windows, if you go up to this View button in Windows Explorer, and you go to, let me see here. Actually, we need to go up to the three dots and go to Options. And we go to the View button. There's a selection right here. It's just should be in the first little window here. Mine is unselected, but yours is probably selected, that says hide extensions for known file types. So I've unchecked that and it allows me to see the extension for all file types. Okay, so if you want to see exactly what I see and you're using Windows, you'll need to adjust that. If anybody has any questions and wants to slow down or go back over something, just ask. Don't hesitate. I'm going to take a bite of cookie now while I pause. I see a hand.
Yeah, is it possible to go back a little bit? You know, I have those three files open just now. I just joined in, so I was sampling.
Sure.
Missing your cookies. So.
You're on campus. Come on by.
Well, I just came back from the lab, so maybe have to step in again.
Okay. all we're doing is downloading these files. If you've downloaded them,
I have opened them just now.
Okay. You're ahead of me then, and I'll catch up.
No. I just had them in my folder.
If they're in your folder, you're right where I am at. So we'll walk through the rest together.
Okay.
So what we're going to do in this, if you did miss the first, where we're heading with this, is that I've designed an exercise and an example to just show a simple but complete statistical analysis with a graphical visualization in R. And there will be no coding required for this. You'll be able to do exactly what I do, and you won't have to code anything. And if you've already got these unzipped and you already have R and RStudio installed, then you'll be able to follow right along. If anybody has had trouble, I don't know if this affects anybody, but if you want to try this right now in this session and you haven't been able to install RStudio yet, what I think I will do is I'll do the demonstration. And then if you need help installing it, we can take some time and install it together. We should be able to do it in a short period of time. So back to these extensions. This folder, and I think I'll just unshare and just share just this window so that it'll be a little bit bigger on your screen. The text you can see is Winter Holiday Agriculture Analysis.R, and it's recognized as being associated with RStudio. This is the symbol for RStudio. If I click on this one, it is a .rmd file. That stands for R Markdown. And it is also just a simple text file associated with RStudio. We won't open either of these yet. I haven't opened any files yet. Then this file here, you might recognize the Excel symbol. It is a .csv or comma separated values file. It's just a text file. Now, if I double click this, because it is associated with Excel in my computer, it will open Excel. But I just want to demonstrate that it's just a text file. Yes, that's just how they appear in the folder. Yes, that looks just fine. I mean, you're using the details view. I can change mine to the details view and it'll look just like yours. I just made it a bit bigger so people could see on my computer. So what I want to do is just show you that the comma separated values file is a format that is only text, but that it formats it as a spreadsheet if we open it in Excel. But yes, I have extracted them from the zip, and you should as well.
No, I didn't mean you. I meant the picture, because at the top. Yeah,
Waseem, you will need to extract those if you haven't done that. Opening them in the zip is not good enough. We need to unzip them. So if you haven't done that, you'll need to do that. If you need help doing that, just let us know. Okay, so I'm just going to right-click. You don't need to do this with me. I'm just going to demonstrate something to you. I'm going to right-click on that CSV file, and I'm going to choose the Open With, and I'm going to choose Notepad. I'm going to stop sharing and reshare my window so you can see the Notepad. So here's the Notepad. What you can see is that there is, on the first row, there is what we call a header. And the header is just the variable names separated by a comma, comma separated values. And on every subsequent row, there are two very precise values. Yes, this is just the CSV file, but I opened it with Notepad. I'm just demonstrating that it's just text. I'll open it up in Excel in a second to look how it looks in Excel. This is how it looks, you know, as text. Neat thing about, and one of the hard things about R that I observe is that if I open this in Excel, give it a second, and I make that a little bit bigger for everybody, and I make those headers so we can read everything. You know, we have Excel trains us to view files like this as ledgers. You know, a spreadsheet is something that's tied to a physical book called a ledger that accountants use. And we've all become accustomed to the way that data are formatted. One of the initial hurdles tied to that learning curve in R is thinking conceptually and abstractly about computer memory and the data that are held there, as opposed to the physical digital model that something like Excel does for us. So we don't need to open this up in Excel at all. It's just comforting for a lot of people to do that. So I just opened it up to demonstrate it to you, but we don't need this at all. I just wanted to show you that we have a couple of values. We have a fertilizer amount. This is the amount per acre in kilograms of some sort of nitrogen mix. And this is the crop yield in, I thought this was a bit funny. I don't know, has anybody ever heard of the measurement of the quintile?
Quintile, 100 kilograms.
So this is crop yield for winter wheat. That's the Christmassy part of this example. It's winter wheat. it's in units of quintiles, which is 100 kilograms. Okay. So I'm just going to close this. Don't need to save it.
Probably something like 2.5 bushel.
Exactly. Per acre.
Exactly. So if you want to follow along, I'm going to open up the one that's the .r file. It's important that we pick the exact one that's .r and not .rmd first. I'm going to go through the plain R code first. All you have to do, if you see that association, is double-click it. It will open up. I'm going to get rid of everything that I ran earlier. Console, going to erase all that. I'm going to close all this stuff. And if you don't have a lot of junk littering up your own R space. Samina, if we'll do that at the end. We'll do a demo at the end to install R. If you hang tight and just watch the demo of the code, we'll swing back around and help you with that. In the meantime, you can either watch the code going, or maybe you could start the download for RStudio or something like that, if you can multitask. Okay. Now, there are a couple of things here. Most of you, if you're just starting to use R, you won't have any libraries loaded. So there's one little exercise that I'll have you do first. This is one we'll take a few minutes to make sure everybody does who wants to follow along. I wanted to explain that I have a metaphor for using R. Some people will have heard this a lot before from me. The metaphor is that the R software is a little bit like, let's say that you're a person that likes to build and fix things. You're a handy person, and you have a garage. Thank you, Iona. You'll also need to download the latest version of R for your operating system as well. You're a handy person. You like to fix things. Maybe you would like to change the inner tube on your bicycle, or maybe you would like to paint your house, or maybe you would like to change the oil in your motorcycle, stuff like that. And it goes from like really easy jobs, maybe this metaphor, like maybe you just want to sweep up a broken bottle with a broom, or maybe you want to do something complicated, like replace the engine in an old motorcycle, you know, a complicated job that takes a long time. Well, to do any of those simple maintenance tasks, you need some tools, and you would need different tools for any of those tasks that I just said. Some of those tasks are real easy and you don't even need much training, but even to sweep up a broken bottle, you might find it handy to have a broom. Now that broom, you know, you might have a short broom, a long broom. You might have a dustpan or just an edge of cardboard. You could do it in several ways. Well, I think that doing statistical tasks is a lot like that example I just gave you. We might want to do something as simple or ambitious, but we need the right tools to do it. And the R system is set up like a garage, where to do a particular task, make a graph, do a particular statistical test, test your assumptions, we may use different tools, and we store those tools in libraries. They're a little bit, you know, I would call them like toolboxes. And all the tools in the toolboxes are functions. Okay, so rather than having toolboxes and tools, we have libraries and functions. Now, one of the things that we often do almost every session in R is we have to load at least one library. And the only one that I want you to load today is called ggplot2. I'm just going to make this a little bit bigger for people to be able to read. You'll already have the code for this, but what you probably don't have, is all of those toolboxes in the whole world. There are about 20,000 of them in R. They don't all come by default. So as you need them, you have to download them. And so one way to download it is to explicitly tell R to download it. And we do that like this with this code. I'll drop this code into the chat. I probably should have put it in the script here. Just going to drop that into the chat. And if you just copy and paste that first thing up into your script, it should look like that. And the way we run these commands in a simple file of text like this in R, we have a couple of options. But if your cursor is on a particular line, we can run that line by just hitting the run button. And I'm just going to do that now. If you're trying to do this in real time with me, just pause for a moment and watch what I do and watch what happens, because that will be eventually, if not the first time, success. We sometimes have to work to achieve success. Okay, so I've just got my cursor on this first line that I've pasted in install.packages ggplot, and I'm going to hit the run button. What's going to happen is you'll see some code down here in the console where my cursor is, and it'll scroll by really quickly, and I'm just going to do it now. 3, 2, 1. And it says they're currently loaded. I already have this package loaded, but I'm going to say, yes, I want to restart my R. It's restarting. And now some stuff is being said. It's downloading all the stuff I need. And it says now the downloaded binary package is in a place on my computer. So that was successful. Just yell if we need to pause and catch everybody up for that, but that will be essential if you've never done that part before. I want to make sure people who haven't done that part before have caught up. But automatically, I didn't move my cursor, but automatically my cursor was advanced to the next line of real code. So my cursor is at the end of line 3 now. And that's the one where now that we've downloaded the library, we just have to load it up. So downloading the library is a bit like buying a toolbox, except it's free to buy these toolboxes. And then loading the library is a bit like opening up that toolbox so that you can use the tools. So I'm just going to click run. 3, 2, 1. Now, what happened down here is that it echoed my command, and it did give me a warning. It said, listen, I'll load this library if you want, but know this, that the library was made for a particular version of R, 4.3.2. That's the latest version of R. If I scroll up, it doesn't show it. If I type version, what I can see is that I'm using version 4.3.1. So one small step version, from the very newest one. Okay, so mine, it probably came out a couple of months ago with the newest version, but that's okay. It will still work. It just gave us a warning, not an error. And I'm going to run this code one step at a time. I'm just going to go through it all. You can follow me if you wish. And if you have any problems, we'll solve the problems at the end. But at this point, I have to do something, and so do you, to be successful here. Because there's this concept in when we use R that is called the working directory. This is one of those irritating things that's super, super annoying when you first start using R. And then eventually you become numb and you just accept it and you do it every time. And you don't even have to make the mistake. You just know that it's going to hit you unless you attend to it. What you have to do, this one is very particular. You can take notes. There are many ways to set your working directory, but the way that I'm going to show you today is if we go up to the session button, there's a section in the session button that says set working directory. And we want to choose the choice that says to source file location. Now remember, the source file is our R script, and we put the source file in a particular folder, and that is going to be our working directory where our data is and everything else. So we have to set our working directory first. So if I just click that, let me show you what happens. 3, 2, 1. It just echoes that it sets the working directory to my desktop and the winter data folder that I made. So that's really the only, we didn't have to code anything. We just have to do that for this to be successful. So I'm going to quickly show you the rest of the steps in this. I'm not going to explain any statistics or anything, because that's not really what this session is about. It's just about showing you the basic mechanics of R. I've got the name of our data file here, and I'm using a function. You know, this is a tool called read.csv. And I'm going to put that in a data object called data. And when we read in data, this little window up here is our global environment. It's a visual representation of what's in our memory space. So when I read this line, up here is going to pop the data object called data with a little description of it, 3, 2, 1. So it says we've got 50 observations of our two variables, fertilizer amount and crop yield, and some examples of what those values are. If I want to print the first two few rows of the data, the first six rows or so, down here in the console, it'll pop up down here. I'm going to do line 11, 3, 2, 1. And we can see some of those values. For those of you who are very observant, you may have observed that the data in that CSV file and the Excel file had a precision of a lot of decimal points. But here in R, we're only displaying the first five. And that's one of the default settings in R. That other decimal accuracy does exist in memory, but we're summarizing it in the global environment. The default there is just one decimal accuracy point, or two if there's no integer. And it's by default globally six in the console. Now, these are both continuous variables. We're going to perform a linear regression. And linear regression is a specific kind of linear model. In R, to do any work, we use a function. And performing a linear regression or any kind of linear model is work. A nice thing about many R functions, not all of them for sure, but for ones that we use a lot, sometimes you can guess the name, or sometimes you can, it's easy to remember the name. For linear model, the basic way to perform one is the function called LM, standing for linear model, of course. And here we're specifying that we want to model crop yield. Use the tilde. Sometimes I like to take a survey when I demonstrate the tilde. I've got a multimodal survey here. Is there anybody who would call this little character something different than tilde? What do you call that?
Tilde.
Tilde. Is there anyone that has another name for it? And I don't want something like squiggle.
I call it the wave.
The wave. Okay, the wave. I've heard squiggle before. I've heard wave now. So it's got a special meaning in R syntax, and it's used to specify a function. And if you're doing a statistical model, the crop yield here on the left side is the dependent variable, and all the variables on the right-hand side of the tilde are explanatory variables or independent variables. And all of those come in one of the spaces in the parentheses for this linear model. There's a starting parenthesis and an ending parenthesis back here. And there are different spaces in the parenthesis that are separated by commas. So the highlighted section here is the first space, then there's a comma, and there's a second space. So the values that go in those spaces, you have to learn these. We don't need to memorize this today. It's just an example, but just explaining how all of the tools in our work, the functions in our work, is for a linear model, we specify the formula in the first space, and then we the name of these spaces, each space has a name. This one is the formula argument, and then the data argument is set to the data set that we read in, which is also called data. That's kind of an unfortunate name to name it the same as the argument, but it's what I usually do. It's my standard practice to name the data set data. So when we run this, we're going to ask it to perform linear regression and put all of the summary stuff for performing a linear model analysis into another object called model. And that's going to pop up in the environment. We haven't asked it to output any text down here. We'll do that next. So we should just see the model pop up here. And down here, we'll see that command on line 14 echoed. 3, 2, 1. So we have our model. It says it's a list of 12 things. Don't worry about that at the moment. But we do want to see what's in the model. And for that, we use the summary function. So we use the summary function. We're doing work on the model object. So we repeat that here. So 3, 2, 1. And what we get out here, we don't have to worry a lot about all the parts of this. But if I just make this a little smaller so it can all fit in one screen. This is the command that we did. And this part is all of the output. And there is a call section. There is a residuals section. There is a coefficients section. And then there's a little line there. And then this is a set of codes. And then finally, a little bit of summary text for a summary of the statistical model. Some of this stuff is redundant. I'm not going to go through this in a lot of detail, but the parts that were most people would be interested in here is this part, the coefficients part. Some people would call this, I would call this a way of summarizing linear model results as an ANOVA table. Even though this, I wouldn't call this analysis an analysis of variance in ANOVA. This is a style of presenting results that have a column for estimates, column of the test statistic for the t-value, a column of p-values. This style of presenting it is an ANOVA table. And one of the things that we see is that the fertilizer amount variable, we want to know usually how much variance it explains and whether that explanation is significant statistically. And we also want to know what the slope of a regression is. So all of that information is buried in here. We just have to find it. I'm just going to quickly point it out. I'm not going to linger on it because this isn't a stats lesson. But the slope is there. That's the estimate for the independent variable. The p-value is there. Now, somewhat unhelpfully, if you have very small p-values, rather than putting less than 0.0001, R puts it in scientific notation. And the smallest number that R can represent is 2 times e to the negative 16. That means it's a very small number, basically. So highly significant. And then the last thing that we tend to want to do is look at the R squared for a regression. That's the amount of variance, proportion of variance explained. And in this case, a high proportion of variance, 87% of the variance in wheat yield is explained by the amount of fertilizer. We're all, I guess we're all agriculture folks, so that shouldn't be surprising to any of us. Now, the last little thing that I want to run here, and this is not a pretty piece of code, and I'm not going to explain this in detail, but this is what a typical nice-looking graph looks like for ggplot. I mentioned, for those of you who joined late, I've only really in the last couple of years started using ggplot almost exclusively. I usually rejected ggplot for a long time. You know, I've been using R for over 20 years because ggplot, it's kind of, you have to write a lot of code to get a nice looking graph, but the graphs are really nice looking. I'm not going to explain what all this code does. Instead, I'm just going to show you the graph. 3, 2, 1. That's what it looks like. Now, to get a graph, there's a lot going on in this graph. And to get a graph that looks this nice with that much packed information, I would say that this is a relatively small amount of code. All we have to do is learn the little pieces, and that's part of what learning R is about. But what we can see from our analysis, we expect from the results, we knew it was highly significant, and we knew that 87% of the variance was explained by fertilizer amount or crop yield. Now, we expect to see a very tight relationship, and indeed we do. This has got a title. It's the effect of fertilizer on crop yield. It's the crop yield in quintals, which is 100 kilogram units. It's in, I don't know where the quintal measure comes from, but it's one of these things like, you know, a cubit or, you know, bushel or something like that. Just one of these traditional measurements that doesn't mean anything to most people these days, I think. But I think it is used in some circumstances still. And then this is the fertilizer amount. This is not a perfect label. It should probably say kilograms per acre. I think that's what was modeled here. It's got a regression line that shows the slope and the intercept of fertilizer amount and crop yield for this regression model. And then the last little bit is it's got every dot is an instance of yield from one field. So this is representing 50 fields of yield. And the cherry on top of this graph is that there is also a color scale that goes from red to green. Now, I don't know if any of you really care about this, but I said that there were some Christmas themes put into this today. So I picked winter wheat for the season, and I also picked red and green for this scale, specifically for this. Red and dark green, my favorites. The red and dark green color scale shows a continuous gradient that matches up with the crop yield value. So that there's a little bit of extra information, visual information in this. Now, this is a pretty good graph. It's probably a little too sassy for, strictly speaking, the scientific literature. You know, we probably wouldn't have that color bar on there, but we probably would have the regression line and also the dots, and the titles are more or less just like we would see them. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to, with my broom, you don't have to do this if you don't want to, but just to keep things simple, I'm going to clean up all of my space, and I'm going to close that script that we just opened. I'm going to go back to my folder. Remember, I had that R markdown. And one of the things I wanted to demonstrate with the exact example I just showed, all the analysis and the graph will be identical for this. But rather than having it in R code, we often use R code when we are just stepping through an analysis for ourselves and exploring the data, and then we have to move the results to some way that we're going to communicate the results. Often this might be a Word document that we're developing, maybe for a report or a manuscript. There is another way, though. I have to say that I have experimented a lot with exclusively going straight from R to a report that is meant to be consumed by someone else, someone who doesn't code in R. It's completely possible, but I haven't totally committed to that even myself, you know, so I use a mixture of automating outputs like figure files and manually editing Word documents. And yet, in a lot of cases, like the web pages that you see for the reports, I'm working on a grant now that makes automated outputs from very complicated data in a dashboard-like setting. There are a lot of situations, primarily if we want to document things on the web, where this language called Markdown is very, very convenient. And I just want to show you how easy it is to work in R. Now, it's a different kind of file. I'm just going to double click this and it will open up in RStudio. It looks aesthetically a little bit different than the R script, but the actual work that is done in this script is identical to the R code that I just showed you. But I want to show you a few little details that are different. If you're really eagle-eyed, you might notice the icon up here is a little bit different to a plain R script. It's very small. You won't be able to see it, but it's got a red circle, and in the red circle is the letters RMD for R Markdown. We have a structure of our code in these kinds of documents that are called chunks. And at the top of every one of these files, in between these dashed strings of characters, is a header for our R Markdown document. And this puts a title on our document that we're going to output. And it also allows us to specify what kind of output we're going to do. In this case, I've specified HTML, but a thing that I use sometimes is I might go straight to Word, I might go straight to PDF, or I might go straight to PowerPoint. But today, I'm going straight to HTML. Now, all of the rest of the code, a nice thing about doing it this way is you have a live document that is generated, analysis, graphs, and everything based on raw data that is analyzed using R code on the fly. And that means that what if I wanted an automated report to report my winter wheat yield and the effectiveness of fertilizing my crops? What if I wanted that every year or every crop season for all of the fields that I'm in control of? What I could do is I could use this exact same code and just change the data. The same code would work exactly the same way, but the actual analysis would be different. So you can start to imagine, if you get and do more ambitious things, more and more ambitious things, how this could be very powerful. So all of the code is in chunks. We have some utility chunks. This first utility chunk loads up the ggplot library just like before. I have some text that could be developed in any kind of text for a real report. I have a code chunk for data. By the way, this hash symbol here in a regular R script, that's a comment that is ignored by R, has a special meaning though in R Markdown. R Markdown is related to hypertext markup language, HTML, that formats code on the web. And if any of you have ever looked at an HTML document, you'll notice that this has a similarity with that, in that the hash symbol indicates section headers or section titles. One hash is a big section title, so the largest and boldest font face. And if we add hashes to that, the font and size gets a little bit smaller and lighter. So these are sections, and each section demarcates a different code chunk. So this one reads our data in and prints the header. This code chunk, and here's a big section and a indented smaller section. This code chunk performs the linear analysis and outputs the summary. And the last section is the plot, and it has exactly the same code as our plot. Now we run this a little bit differently. So what is happening here is we've given it instructions for how we want our HTML page to look. And then the whole page will be analyzed in R, just like before. But in addition to that, automatically, the HTML code to produce a document, or the code to produce a Word document or a PDF or a PowerPoint, will be done for us behind the scenes, and up will pop a web page. So the way we run this is we go up to this knit button, and we're going to choose knit to HTML. Now knit R, knit is a framework for creating automatic HTML code that it transcends R. It's useful for all sorts of programming languages. And the version that we use in R is called knitter, and it's got little knitting and ball of yarn symbols. So it's all very cute. I've just clicked it. I see the little stop sign is playing, and that means something is happening. And then up pops my HTML page with an introduction section, our data section, shows us the header, our analysis section where it performs the regression. And this is a little untidy, you know, it's just a raw output of stats, but I am just giving the concept here, and you could format this to output all of these sections in a more formatted format if you wanted to, and you probably would. And then the plot code, and we've got our nice little plot, and we could write a figure legend if we wish. I guess the only thing that I would point out on this is that I've left the code visible, but by for most applications for creating a report, you'd want to hide that code and have it just behind the scenes, because the greatest use for this would either be in an instructional setting. You'd probably want to show the code where folks would be able to see the code and the output together in a nicely formatted package. I use that all the time for, if you've taken any of my classes or the boot camp that we'll go through in the starting the beginning of the year. But otherwise, if this is for the gentle eyes of non-programmers, for managers or supervisors or whatever, you would definitely hide that code and just have the automation behind there, the reproducible automation. So we're almost out of time. I know some people were going to download R and install it. If you need help, we will do that. I think that is all I have to say, so I'll open it up for some questions or comments.
Basically, my question is on using R Markdown to make your reproducible output, something. Let's say you are writing a scientific report, and then let's say you want to save it in weight. That means you have to develop your report, let's say working in weight, and then you put the contents of your text in the R Markdown, including the everything else. And then you hide the code, and then you come up with a report. If I'm getting right, that's how you go about it, right? And then you have an excellent report that you can maybe submit a research report or something. And
yes, exactly like that. In fact, R Markdown, the way that it works like this is, I know that you have used Python and IPython notebooks. And this is very similar to IPython notebooks.
Okay.
So here we're just dealing directly with the code. In IPython notebooks, you have code chunks. You have your text in different sections, either a text chunk or a code chunk. It's exactly the same here. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's excellent.
Yes.
And on reproducibility, I know that, you know, in Python, we use JIT reports. So you have, you kind of, that's easy for you. If I send you a report that I generated, let's say, I mean, I was sourcing my data from a GitHub repository, definitely you'd be able to access the data. But what I see in R most of the times is that we set working directory to our local computers. So my question would be is that standard for reproducibility of the report? If someone wants to access maybe the data source,
yeah,
how does that work?
Yeah, well, you may have noticed that I didn't set my working directory when I closed down and restarted R between the R script and this. And the default behavior of, you're right, you always need to keep track of where your files are and how that works. But the default behavior for Markdown for GitHub or whatever application you're using it, where multiple people will be using it on multiple computers, the default behavior for Markdown is that the directory where you open your Markdown document becomes the working directory for the knitting. So by default, it uses a local file structure for that. It's kind of a high-level question, but it's a good question. So we don't have to worry about that if we're using RStudio for our markdown. So we just have to set our where it's looking for our data. We would just have to set that to a relative location to where the markdown file is, whatever folder that may be. Yeah.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. We're about out of time. If there aren't any comments, or if there are, I'm happy to stay for a little while and help people if they are installing and run into some problems. But what I wanted to say is that what we'll do next year, and I'll send out an email probably the first week of January, is what I'll aim to do is there are 12 different pages up on the R bootcamp, and I'll aim to cover those one page per week, starting probably with the second page, but maybe the first page is better. What the first page does is it just goes through the installation of R and RStudio. So if we have a meeting to do that first, it will be just doing the nuts and bolts for people that haven't done it. I think what I'm also going to try to do when I do those is to set up so that I record a bit of a lecture during those meetings in the start that introduces the concepts of the lab. And then that recording will be there for posterity for people who can't also attend in case there are some people who want to keep up but can't attend some weeks, who might have to miss a week. So I think that's my idea now. Okay. Do you think that will work? Is that what people have in mind?
I think this is what they need, as far as I know, as far as I understand from the meeting. But obviously, there is a group of people who can comment on it.
Yeah. Any comments about that? Will that work for everyone?
Yes, that would work for me.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Seeing some thumbs up. It's been a very, very busy, and I have to say a stressful term for me. And I'm looking forward to taking these 2 weeks off. Sometimes I think the winter holiday comes and I think, oh my God, what am I going to do for 2 weeks? I end up doing loads of work, but I've set up a number of physical tasks around my house so that I'm away from my computer most of the days. So I probably won't be back and probably won't be answering emails or anything, but I'll look forward to catching up with everybody after the holiday break, and I'll see everyone in January.
All right. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays.
Merry Christmas to you.
Happy Christmas.
Happy holidays.
Merry Christmas to everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Art. Thank you.
Pleasure. See everyone later. Yeah.